My, what a good assembly we have this morning. We welcome all of you to the Church of Christ here at Old Cedar. As look out over the audience, I do see visitors in our presence today. We are truly humbled and honored to come our way. We don't just say that. We truly mean. We hope you'll stay around for a few moments afterwards today. Let us get to know you already. Welcome you to our worship today. We trust that our worship will be fulfilling. To be in spirit and in truth, and go home better than we came. It's always our desire to grow spiritually. Next Sunday is our homecoming. It's a day we all love here at Old Cedar so very much. A lot of work has already been done, getting ready for this special day. Every Lord's Day is special, but when we can bring others of the family of God back with us that maybe situations in life have taken them away from us, whether it be job or marriage or circumstances beyond their control, they can come back home and be with us. It's just a little foretaste of heaven to come, isn't it? Heaven is going to be the greatest homecoming of all with our loved ones that we've known in this life or going on to be with the Lord. And this will give us a little foretaste of that. So be invited your family, your friends, and loved ones to come and be with us this special day next Sunday. As we turn your Bibles today, 1 John chapter 2, 1 John chapter 2, we're going to look this morning at verses 1 through 6 to get our text. If you are here today, you're not a New Testament Christian, you're not saved. My heart goes out to you, because I can't imagine living one moment without Jesus Christ in my life, knowing the fear that is in your heart, that if you took your last breath, you'd wake up in a place of darkness and not be with God and your loved ones for all eternity. If there's needs in your life spiritually today, if you're as a Christian and not where God needs you to be, I hope today that you'll realize that and realize how much we love you, how much God loves you, and that you'll come home today. 1 John chapter 2, verse 1 beginning. John, the beloved apostle, writes and he says, "My little children, these things I write to you so that you may not sin. And if anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And he himself is the propitiation for our sins. And not for ours only, but also for the whole world. Now by this we know that we know him." Do you know that you know him today? "By this we know that we know him, if we keep his commandments. He who says, 'I know him,' and does not keep his commandments is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whoever keeps his word, truly the love of God is made complete in him. By this we know that we are in him." Look at verse 6. "He who says he abides in him ought himself also to walk just as he walks." We'll stop right there. Do you know the way that you walk says a lot about your personality? Confident people tend to walk with a bounce in their step and they take wider strides. Depressed people tend to shuffle their feet and they walk a lot slower. Insecure people, they may walk with their hands in their pockets and their head tilted downward. While proud or arrogant people may walk with their heads held high and their nose up in the air. Worldly and loose people tend to walk with a strut or a swagger. Now, we're all going to be a little more self-conscious about the way we walk from now on, aren't we? Well, beloved, do you know the way you walk says a lot about you spiritually? In today's scripture text, John reveals the difference between how an authentic Christian walks and how a counterfeit Christian walks. And I'll give you a clue. It has nothing to do with putting one foot in front of the other. But you know, the Bible frequently refers to our life as a walk as a Christian. We just sang that song, "Hand in Hand, We Walk Each Day with Jesus." You remember Enoch, the great man of old, in Genesis 5 and verse 4, the Bible says he walked with God. Romans 6 and verse 4 tells us when we become Christians, when we are raised up out of that watery grave of baptism, and we don't have the blood of Jesus Christ applied to our life, we're to walk in newness of life. Our walk has to do, beloved, with the way we live our lives and conduct ourselves in this world. So, how does an authentic Christian walk? That's what John is showing us this morning. Now, young people, when I use the word authentic, I'm talking about genuine. Like the old Coca-Cola commercial, the real thing. It is genuine. It is the real thing. So, John shows us how an authentic Christian is to walk. And listen to what he has to say as we break that down this morning. Truth number one. I'll make 3 points. The message will be yours. Truth number one. John shows us an authentic Christian in this text. He walks away from sin. He walks away from sin. Back up in chapter 1 and verse 6, John clearly exposes the counterfeit Christianity of his day of the Gnostics, who claimed to be Christians and yet they continued to walk in their past sins. There was no change in their life. He says in chapter 1 and verse 6, he says, if we say we have fellowship with him and yet we walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth. And now, from chapter 1, John now carries that same idea over the first two verses of our text here in chapter 2. And the first point John makes here is he gives an admonition not to sin. My little children, verse 1. These things are written to you that you do not sin. Now in 1 John chapter 1 and verse 9, again the previous chapter, he had just stated if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Now, some may interpret that to mean this. Well, as long as I confess my sins after I commit them, then God will forgive me, so it's okay for me to sin. But John quickly dispels this false notion here in verse 1 of chapter 2 when he says, my dear children, I write this to you so that you do not sin. What he is saying, that you do not live a lifestyle of sin. That you do not live in sin as a way of life eventually every day. That when you become a Christian, there's to be a change in our walk and our talk and how we conduct ourselves in this world. You know, the Apostle Paul, just like John here, he found this to be a problem in the church in his day at the church of Rome. Because the first thing he said in Romans 6 and verse 1 is, what shall we say then, talking to the children of God? Shall we continue in our sins that the grace of God may abound? And he said, God forbid. How shall we that have died to our old way of life, or we've died to our past and our sins in the past, how can we live any longer in that? While it is impossible for any of us to live perfectly and sinless lives, John is showing us it is possible to walk away from sin as a way of life through the power of God's Spirit and God's Word. You see, an authentic Christian will sin on occasions. We all do. Whether it's by thought or by tongue or sometimes by action. But it's not something we mean to do. We don't get up in the morning looking for sin. It's not a way of life, but yet we're human. And if we can be perfect, we would have had to die on the cross. But what he says here is a true authentic Christian will never use the grace of God and forgiveness as a license to keep on sinning in that thing that we enjoy. An authentic Christian, John says, will walk away from sin as a way of life. Well, next John points out in this text the assurance we have when we do sin, as we all often do. Verse 1 again, he says, and if anybody does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. And he is the atoning sacrifice. He is the propitiation for our sins, and not for our sins only, but also the sins of the whole world. All 7 billion people alive this morning on planet Earth, Christ died for their sin, just like he did for ours. Well, John is reminding us here as our advocate, as our propitiation, a very special ministry. A special ministry that Christ now exercises in heaven on behalf of you and I. You know, Christ is our defense attorney. He is our counselor. He is the one who represents us before God because, again, that's why we pray in Jesus' name, because we're not worthy to talk to a holy God as sinful man. It took the atoning sacrifice of the perfect Jesus Christ, and he is our go-between. He is our mediator, our link to God. So he is our defense attorney. John is showing us where every Christian, someone has truthfully said, Jesus was born a carpenter. He died a preacher, and now in heaven he's a lawyer. Let me explain what John is saying here in being our propitiation for our sins or our advocate. You know, when we as Christians sin, and we all do, it's as if we stand as the accused in the heavenly court. We stand before our righteous God, the righteous judge, God the Father. And we know that Jesus, our defender, our advocate, he stands up to answer the charges against us by Satan as we confess our sins to God. Why? Again, picture the heavenly court and our sins come up before God, the righteous judge. And Satan is the accuser of the brethren. He's always the one accusing us before God. Revelation 12 and verse 10, John speaks of Satan as the accuser of the brethren. You see, Satan is like the prosecuting attorney. Jesus is always there to look at the right hand of our righteous God, the judge. Christ is there as our advocate, our counselor, and our defense attorney, pleading our innocence through his precious blood as we confess our sins to God. Now to relate that, you think about in a criminal court today, when a human defense attorney pleads for the innocence of his client, and even though his client may be guilty of a heinous crime or act, that attorney still pleads the innocence of his client. And yet Christ, our defense attorney, is always there before the righteous judge to plead for our defense. Even when we have stumbled miserably in our sins, we are guilty before God. Christ pleads as we confess those sins for our innocence. Again, Romans 3:23 says we've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But Christ is right there, John says, at the right hand of the Father. And he's our propitiation. He's our advocate. He is our atonement for sin. And you think about all that Christ has gone through for us. After all he did for me on Calvary. After all the love and grace and mercy that God has shown me. After all that Christ has defended me before my heavenly Father when I've sinned time and time again. After all he's done, why? John is asking. Why in the world would I choose to willfully sin before God every day of my life and live an open life of sin or live a secret life of sin or a lifestyle of sin? John shows us here a real Christian, a true child of God. An authentic Christian walks away from a sinful lifestyle. Well, number two, John shows us in this text that an authentic Christian walks in obedience. That is, with humility in our hearts. Not God, I'm going to do it my way, but Lord, I surrender my all to you. He walks in obedience. Remember, I told you earlier, you can tell the difference between an authentic Christian and a counterfeit Christian by the way they walk. John makes that crystal clear here in verses 3 through 5. He says here in verse 3 that an authentic Christian walks in obedience. Look at it. We know that we have come to know him if we keep his commandments. Verse 5, but if anyone keeps his word, God's love is perfected in him. By this we know that we know him. So, beloved, when one becomes a child of God, You'll be seeing in a changed life and a changed attitude towards sin. You see, that's why we're born of the water and the Spirit. Born of the water is when we're born of that water and river baptism. We contact the blood of Jesus Christ. But when we're born of the Spirit, there's that inward change in our life. That transformation in our heart to determine, I'm not going to live the old sinful life I used to live anymore. I'm going to be dead to the old man that I used to be, or the old woman I used to be. And I'm going to do my best to walk away from that sin in my life that I once enjoyed. That's what John is saying to you. You see, an authentic Christian no longer loves to sin like they once did. Young people, they can't drink a beer with their old buddies. Moms and dads, they can't go to Tunic or Las Vegas or Sin City and really be comfortable and really have a good time and enjoy themselves. An authentic Christian no longer likes to hang out in the old sinful places, maybe, that they used to go. An authentic Christian no longer brags about sin the way they once did. You know, sin is nothing to brag about, is it? Yet we see those in the world very boastful about their lifestyles. An authentic Christian is no longer comfortable in the presence of his old buddies or her old sinful girlfriends, the old crowd maybe that used to lead them astray. An authentic Christian is no longer finding pleasure in the sinful things that once brought them pleasure. As the song states, all the vain things that charm me most, I sacrifice them to his blood. And notice John says in verse 5, but if anyone obeys his word, God's love is truly made complete in him. Now, what does that mean? It means the greatest way for you and I to demonstrate that my love for God is genuine. I'm not perfect, but I'm doing my humanly best to live the Christian life by the grace of God. The way we show that, he says, is by obeying his commands. 1 John 5, verse 3, John says, this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous. What does that mean? His commandments are not grievous. That is, they're not burdensome. I've told you several times, the commandments of God are not for his good. They're for ours. You know, God gives us his commandments because he loves us, just like a mother and father will give directions to their children, instructions to their children to keep them safe. Well, that's what the commandments of God are for. And again, young people, if we ignore those commandments in this society we live in today, and we're morally loose, and we're sexually active in ways that we shouldn't be active, and that is a growing trend more and more in this permissive society of young people and others. If we do that, we may suffer from that. Because we're going against the commands of God. When we do that, we may suffer from STDs or AIDS or even death. Young people, when we disobey the commands of God and we partake in alcohol or drugs or tobacco, that's probably going to lead to some future problems. It may be health problems or even worse. So when John says that we are to show our love for God by keeping his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous, he's telling us that they're for our own good, because they come from a loving God who's trying to keep us pure and keep us safe and holy and humble. So John shows us here an authentic Christian walks in obedience. And then he shows the opposite. Look at verse 4. He shows a counterfeit Christian. And young people, when I say counterfeit, we know that that's not genuine. We see those that have tried to make counterfeit money in the past. It's not real. And here is John in verse 4 is showing a counterfeit Christian walks in disobedience. Look at it. Verse 4. The man or the woman who says, I know him, I'm saved, I'm a Christian, I know him, but does not keep his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. Now that's not. John is saying the man or woman who claims to know Christ, and yet they want to continue in their willful disobedience to God, their old sinful lifestyle, John says to God, that person is a liar, a fake, a fraud, a counterfeit. John is showing they're not genuine. They're not the real thing. Like the old saying we've heard before, hypocrites, just not themselves on Sunday. You see, beloved, what John is showing us is when you and I claim to be Christians, and yet we live in habitual disobedience to God, then I am lying to God. I am lying to myself. I'm lying to others. I'm deceiving myself. James 1 in verse 22. So John in this text shows us an authentic Christian will walk away from a sinful lifestyle. Number two, he says an authentic Christian will walk in humble obedience to God. And finally, this morning, number three, John shows us an authentic, real Christian walks as Jesus walked. Read verse 6. He who says he abides in him ought himself also to walk just as he walked. Now that doesn't mean we walk on water, does it? That doesn't mean that we're to put on long robes and sandals and travel everywhere on foot like Jesus walked in his day. And it certainly doesn't mean that we must live a perfect, sinless life and that we're above sin. No. But what John is saying is this. It's one thing to claim to know Christ, but yet the real proof is seen in our practice, in our lives outside these doors on Monday through Saturday. That's how we really pass the test. Many are talking the talk, but an authentic Christian will walk the walk. So, how can I tell if I'm walking as Jesus walked? Well, how did Jesus walk? Well, first of all, we know Jesus walked in humility. Paul said in Jesus in Philippians 2 and verse 8, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even the death of the cross. You think about what Christ has done. He left the highest honor in heaven, the King of Kings, to come down and become a mortal man. He was the King of Kings, and yet he became a lowly servant of his creation. As the creator of all creatures, he made sure the foxes had holes to sleep in, that the birds of the air had a nest, yet he himself had no place to lay his head. That's humility, isn't it? And yet, in the greatest act of humility ever displayed, Jesus allowed himself to be numbered among the transgressors. The lowest of the low. He was right there with the worst criminals of his day and crucified between the worst thieves of that day. Dying on the cross of Calvary. That's humility. So ask yourself, is there even the slightest hint of pride and self-righteousness in me this morning? Am I boastful? Do I find myself patting myself on the back a lot? Do I like to toot my own horn when I do good deeds for others? Am I preoccupied with my wants and my desires and my needs and my preferences and my rights and happy things my way? Am I selfless or selfish? You and I are to walk as Jesus walked. Beloved, we're to walk in humility. Micah 6 and verse 8 says, he has shown you, O man, what is good, but what did the Lord require of thee? To do justly, to love mercy. Number three, to walk humbly with thy God. That is, having an humble spirit, always said, Lord, what would you have me to do? Finally, this morning, Jesus walked in goodness. So was done. Peter said of Christ, Acts 10:38, he went around
doing good.
Ask yourself, do I go around doing good for others? I'm so busy in this life, and I've got my own family. But yet, do I invest my life in others? Do I find myself helping others carry their burdens? When there's a loss in one's life of a dear loved one or their health, am I there for them to help them maybe with food or necessities of life, or to pick them up and give them an encouraging word and say, I love you, I'm here for you? Do I bring hope and joy and courage to the lives of others? Or is my whole world just wrapped up in my own scheme? And I'm so busy, I ain't got time for nobody. You and I are to walk as Jesus walks. We're to walk in goodness. Well, that's one of the nine fruit of the Spirit we're to have in our life, Galatians 5:22. Of love and joy and peace, long-suffering, gentleness, and goodness, faith, meekness, and self-control. I told you at the outset of our message, you can tell a lot about a person for the way he walks. Yet that's especially true when it comes to the walk of a true child of God. The way you know this morning, am I a true, genuine, authentic child of God in his eyes this morning? Number one, have I walked away from my sin? Number two, am I walking in obedience and humility? Number three, am I walking as Jesus walks? In humility and in goodness. Let me share with you this one final thought, and then we'll close. Early historians tell the story of a Christian man who was martyred for his faith. Most of the early Christians of that first century died because of their faith. That's why the Apostle John said in Revelation 2 and verse 10, be thou faithful unto the point of death, and I'll give you the crown of life. Most all those precious early Christians had to die if they didn't denounce their faith in Jesus. This man, who was about to be put to death, the historians report, the executioners asked the man, what are you? He said, I am a Christian. They said, what trade do you follow? He said, I am a Christian. They asked, what language do you speak? Again, he answered, I am a Christian. Then they asked him, what treasures do you have? His response was, I am a Christian. You see, with death facing that man, looking him square in the eyes, all that man was, all that he had, all that he hoped to be, were wrapped up in Jesus Christ. And that man walked as Jesus walked, in obedience, in humility, in holiness, and in love and goodness. That, my friend, is how an authentic Christian is to walk. Today I want you to ask yourself, am I walking hand in hand with Jesus? You ask yourself, you cannot say, I'm not walking with God, I've sort of walked away from Him. I'm not walking parallel with Him, and I've gotten away from Him. I find myself at times not even talking to Him or praying to Him unless I'm in trouble. I find myself getting so busy I never open my Bible unless maybe I'm here. You see, if we're not walking with Him now, He's not going to be there for us to walk with us that one day that we will one day walk that valley in the shadow of death. Psalms 23, David said, yea, though I walk through that valley of the shadow of death, I won't fear any harm, for thou art with me. Can you say today, you're walking with Him? And if you left this old world today, He'd be there to walk with you. Today, if you're not a Christian, if you're not saved, come today. God loves you. He's there with His outstretched loving arms and would love to assist you in becoming a Christian today. Putting on the Lord in baptism. leaving here with a clean new slate, walking a new life. You walked away from the Lord in your life. Maybe you didn't mean to, but you've gotten distracted. You've got your priorities out of order. You know you're not where you need to be with God. Come home today. He loves you. We can start all over this morning. But together we stand.